Hello guys, Dr. Carlo Ogeri, emergency physician and medical director at Cartersville Medical Center. Today we had a lecture for the EMS crews about stroke mimics and stroke chameleons. And I wanted to be able to share it not only with people who weren't there, but with everybody else here in YouTube. So I hope you enjoy this presentation. Before we get started, let's talk about a little background about strokes. There was a recent study by Lipman that wanted to look at differentiation between strokes and stroke mimics and find out how good are we at diagnosing this. They looked at consecutive patients that presented to the emergency department over a two-year period. The definition of stroke was the sudden onset of a focal neurological deficit that persisted past an hour. The diagnosis of stroke was made not just by ER doctors, but neurologists and very well-trained nurses. And they did this before the CAT scan was done, before they knew the result. It was considered for them to have done an accurate diagnosis if the CAT scan showed a stroke or a hemorrhagic stroke, which are both two types of strokes. And they found out that 75% of the time they got it right. That means that one in every four patients they got it wrong. Of slightly more than 400 patients initially diagnosed with strokes, 19% of them were found to have mimics of strokes, and thus why I'm making this lecture, to highlight the importance of the recognition of stroke mimics and stroke chameleons. Out of these 19%, it was further subdivided into 17% were actually seizure disorders with paralysis, 17% with systemic infections, 15% were brain tumors, and 13% with metabolic or toxic disturbances that presented as strokes. There were 14 other diagnoses, which included positional vertigo, trauma, subdural hematomas, and syncope. So let's start and talk about the specific stroke mimics and discuss each one. Transient hypoglycemia, low blood sugar, can produce a stroke-like picture, even with hemiplegia and aphasia, and this we've known for many years. That's why the EMS and the paramedics always know to check the blood sugar before they bring a patient in who has stroke-like symptoms. It is very embarrassing that once a patient gets here, gets a CAT scan, blood work, we're activating a stroke protocol, and then it ends up being that the patient's hypoglycemic. So we know to check for this. These patients may be drowsy, but are often alert and might not show the more common response to hypoglycemia, like confusion, diminished level of consciousness, or coma. The aphasia can make it even more difficult for us to get a history of diabetes because the patient cannot tell us that they're diabetic. The syndrome has also been reported in alcoholics with hypoglycemia. The pathogenesis of this focal CNS dysfunction is really unclear. Hypoglycemia is generally defined as a blood glucose level less than 45 milligrams per deciliter. Now, in practice, we take anything under 60 as hypoglycemia, and at least give them a juice or some sugar drink, but anything below 45 needs to be emergently treated. The wide use of bedside rapid laboratory testing for glucose now makes this easily detectable and treatable. The hemiplegia may resolve immediately upon giving the D50, dextrose 50. However, it can take hours for the brain glucose to go up and the symptoms of hypoglycemia to resolve. In these pictures from left to right, we have a subdural hematoma, a cerebral abscess, and a primary CNS tumor. But also, metastatic tumors, all of these are different reasons for people to present with stroke-like symptoms or simulating a stroke. The typical clinical presentation of a slowly increasing mass is what is usually characterized as progressive syndrome. An abrupt onset of symptoms of these masses seems counterintuitive. A review of patients with brain tumors presenting to the emergency department showed that 6% of patients had symptoms that were less than 1 day's duration. It was thought that these patients with brief symptom duration might reflect a subpopulation who suffer acute deterioration from a hemorrhage into the tumor or who develop obstructive hydrocephalus. That means they can't really drain their fluid from the brain, it gets swollen. Secondary effects of mass or edema on cerebral vasculature may have been identified as possible causes of the abrupt onset of seizures as well. Chronic subdural hematoma has been frequently reported as the cause of stroke and TIA symptoms. Let's talk about seizures and post-ictal states. Every study identifying stroke mimics identifies seizures and post-seizure events as common causes of stroke-like conditions. Traditional thought is that these post-ictal symptoms are manifestations of seizure-induced alterations in neuronal function that are reversible. Structural neuronal alterations are not really present. The post-ictal weakness or Todd's paralysis usually follows partial motor seizures, but may follow generalized seizures as well. Duration is usually brief, but the symptoms may last up to 48 hours. Rare inhibitory seizures with extreme weakness as manifestations of the seizure event have been reported as well. Seizures may also be present as a complication of a stroke, or develop in a patient with a history of stroke because that area of the brain is irritated and the neurons can activate themselves and get hyperactive and cause a seizure. Most studies have identified post-ictal states indirectly after further seizures were observed or additional history was obtained that suggested a history of a seizure disorder.
So this little guy is how old?
He's 20 months.
He's 20 months? Mm-hmm. And he came in here today after a seizure. His mother said that he generally has the seizures after he has, as he wakes up from a nap. And that seemed to be the case today. Today you said that his left arm was limp.
His left arm was limp.
And that's happened once before?
Yes, the last time, about a month ago.
Okay.
Had a seizure. And normally, last time he had foam, he was foaming out the mouth, his crib was full of foam. This time, the crib was soaking wet.
So, okay.
But I didn't see the foam like last time,
yeah.
But it was soaking wet where he drooled.
Okay. Much. And then when you saw him, his right leg was like up in the air?
When I first got him out the crib, his right leg was still straight.
Okay.
And this one was slightly stiff. After when I took him out the crib and laid him on his side, that's when he started moving his leg and he started cocking his leg up.
Okay.
You know, where the ambulance saw him.
Could you demonstrate the weakness in his arm, mm-hmm. compare the two arms? Now he'll hold that. He'll use that right arm.
This video you can find on Larry Melick's channel, which he has a lot of good educational videos and stuff like that. So that's a quote. You can go to his channel and watch this on YouTube. Let's talk about migraine mimicking stroke. Migraine may actually precipitate stroke. Actually, migraine headaches are a risk factor for stroke because the pathophysiology of how migraines happen, you get an initial vasoconstriction followed by vasodilation. But if that vasoconstriction is significant enough, it can cause a stroke. But there is also a variant of migraine called hemiplegic migraine, where unilateral hemiparesis outlasts the headache. This is difficult, if not impossible, to diagnose correctly at the first presentation when it must be regarded as a diagnosis of exclusion. Only with recurrent, stereotypic attacks can this be suspected. Causes, also, there are cases of alternating hemiplegia. At times, this disorder has been observed to be a familial. Now let's talk about a functional hemiparesis. Little has been written about factitious or fake stroke, yet several studies discover rare patients initially have to have a stroke, cerebrovascular disease, but later determined to have a functional cause of the hemiparesis or other stroke symptoms. Conversion disorder is the most commonly assigned psychiatric disorder. One study of emergency department presentations of conversion disorders noted that symptoms of paresis, paralysis, or movement disorders were common and were a presentation in 30% of the patients. They noted significant comorbidities in this population, often other psychiatric disorders, and emphasized that conversion disorder is a diagnosis of exclusion. Patients often undergo multiple diagnostic tests before the diagnosis is assigned. Now let's talk about encephalopathies and other toxic metabolic conditions that have stroke-like presentations. Hyperglycemia. Now we talked about before about hypoglycemia, but hyperglycemia with a hyper or smaller state may be associated with focal neurological deficits, simulating a stroke. But focal seizures are also reported in this condition as well. Focal neurologic signs with hyperglycemia may include aphasia, homonymous hemianopsia, hemisensory deficits, hemiparesis, unilateral hyperreflexia, and even the presence of a Babinski sign. Other metabolic encephalopathies reported to cause stroke-like conditions include a low sodium or hyponatremia, and hepatic encephalopathy, which is the result of liver failure with high ammonia levels.